Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. I know there's a number of events going on, so we appreciate your attention. First of all, I just want to once again to speak briefly about the Issues Conference. We had a very successful Issues Conference. I want to thank the Vice Chair of our caucus for her support. Can you hear? You're fine? We had a very successful Issues Conference. I'm very pleased with the speakers, with the agenda that was there in Baltimore. And important steps in developing our message as we go forward that resonates with all Americans, fighting for all Americans. So we're energized, we're unified in our goal of offering alternatives to President Trump and the Republican Congress. We're opposing the irresponsible legislation the GOP is pushing through this week, including efforts to make it harder for workers to save for retirement. They're seriously going to make it more difficult for Americans to save for retirement. This is something that I've been working on for quite some time now in terms of the creation of a portable national pension. And they're going the exact opposite way by limiting or eliminating the ability of localities and cities and states to help to incentivize savings in the United States. It's crazy. They're also continuing their attacks on Planned Parenthood. But shockingly, that's not the most disturbing news coming from the congressional Republicans and President Trump this week. That would, of course, be the issue of National Security Advisor, or I should say former National Security Advisor, Michael Flynn, and the revelations that he indeed discussed easing sanctions with the Russian government even before President Trump was sworn in. And then that he lied about it to Vice President Pence, who then lied to the American people on behalf of the administration. I think it was the right call for Flynn to resign or be pushed out of office, but this is larger than Flynn. He wasn't fired because he lied. Let's make that clear. He was not fired because he lied. He was fired because he just wasn't a good enough liar. They were okay with lying to the American people. It's only when they got caught that someone had to pay the price. And in this case, it wasn't going to be Mr. Trump. President Trump, it would be Mr. Flynn. It's becoming increasingly clear that President Trump is leading a very dysfunctional White House. So the real question with respect to Flynn is, what did Trump know? What did President Trump know? And when did he know it? Harkening back to Howard Baker, Senator Baker, you know, who is today's modern Howard Baker? Who amongst my Republican colleagues in the House or the Senate will step up? Clearly, at this point, not Chavez, nor Senator Johnson. We know that Congressman Nunes is already trying to sweep this under the rug, as if don't look here, nothing's really here to look at. Did the president order Flynn to call the Russians? Did he seriously not know that his campaign advisor was calling Russians? What does President Trump have to hide? We know the White House and President Trump was aware for at least 1 month of the contents of Flynn's call to the Russians. This is why we need a real investigation into Russia and the hacking of the American elections. This is not the end. This is just the beginning. Let's be clear about that. This is not going to be the end. This is going to be just the beginning. Congress should fully investigate both President Trump's ties to Russia and to Vladimir Putin, and the situation that allowed a Trump National Security Campaign advisor to feel so comfortable and so at ease in making the type of call that he made to the Russians, and in the process, his breaking the law. Indicative of a larger problem, Trump doesn't have time to help Americans because of all the scandals that are taking place within just a three-week period. President Trump spending so much time trying to run a barely functioning White House, no attention is being paid to the American people. All the promises that he had made, no economic boost, no job growth. And so we recognize the challenge that is ahead of us. This is not just about President Trump. This is about our Republican colleagues and the separation of powers and holding this president accountable for the lies that have been taking place in the White House that have made America less safe. That is what this is about. As I said, this is not the beginning. This is not the end. This is just the beginning. And with that, I want to turn over to my colleague, Linda Sanchez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, everyone. Happy Valentine's Day. After a very successful 2017 Issues Conference, House Democrats are back at work this week with a renewed focus on the fight for America's working families. Meanwhile, Republicans are reeling after a string of self-inflicted wounds last week caused by the Trump White House. On Friday, good reporting by the Washington Post revealed that National Security Advisor Michael Flynn apparently lied about his discussion with Russian officials about ending some U.S. sanctions against Russia. And last night, more damning reports came out from the Justice Department, raising serious concerns that Michael Flynn may have been compromised and was susceptible to blackmail by the Russians, ultimately leading to Flynn's middle-of-the-night resignation. Now, it's also being reported that Michael Flynn is under investigation by the Army for taking money from the Russian government during a trip he took to Moscow in 2015 in violation of the Emoluments Clause of the Constitution. Since before Election Day, Democrats and those in the intelligence community have been sounding the alarm about the role the Russian government has played in influencing our elections. There are countless links between the Trump team and the Russian government. There are now three Trump advisors who've been forced to resign due to their cozy relationship with Putin: Page, Manafort, and now Flynn. This latest batch of news only raises more questions about the reach of Russia's influence into the White House. So we have a few questions for the Trump administration. Was the president aware of these entanglements before he appointed General Flynn to be the National Security Advisor? And if not, why not? He should have had that information at his disposal. Number two, how far does Russian influence among senior White House House staff reach? And number three, who else inside the Trump administration might also be caught up in the tangled web of Russian influence? These are all serious questions that Congress needs to look into right now. This is not a Republican or Democratic issue. This is about our national security. We cannot have a branch of our government susceptible to outside Russian influence. So, Republicans in the House, I beg you, please put your country's national security interests above your party interests. Please be the patriots that you claim you are and step up and look into draining the swamp that exists inside the White House. Speaker Ryan, Jason Chaffetz, Devin Nunes, where is your spine? Where is your patriotism? Do you care about our national security? Because if you do, you cannot sweep this under the rug. You cannot turn and look the other way. You guys have the power within the Congress to investigate all of these entanglements, and I beg you, to stand up and do what's right for the country. And with that, I will turn it back over to our chairman.
Let me just also just reiterate, the Russian people are not our enemy. And we know that the Russian people want better relations with the United States, as we do with them as well. But we also know that Vladimir Putin is not our friend. His interests are not the advancement of the cause of the United States and freedom around the world. His immediate goal is to take care of Vladimir Putin, and second, maybe the Russian people. But it is not remotely in his top 1,000 points to help the United States of America. That is what troubles me so much about President Trump's odd behavior, again, when it comes to the issue of Vladimir Putin. Wanting to cozy up to him to the point that he will reject the information provided by our intelligence community, men and women who put their lives on the line to collect that information and take then the word over a dictator over them. That has got to be troubling to the American people. And what is happening right now with Flynn, the level of lying that's gone on, again, it's not about the lie, it's about he got caught. They were perfectly fine with the lies that went on. It's only when they got caught that someone had to pay the price. So with that, we'll open up.
Mr. Yeah. Mr. Chairman, consequences here. Both of you asked a number of questions about, you know, you laid out several questions, what happened. What if some of those questions are to say, yes, the president didn't, or that this was directed by the president? What are those consequences in your mind when you consider the ramifications, the very high-level ramifications?
Well, I think it's premature to say what the consequences ought to be. But what we do need to have is a full investigation. We need to find out what they knew, when they knew it, whether a directive was given by the president to Flynn to make those calls, to make a call. We're not even sure if this is the only call, by the way. There may very well have been other calls or even roundabout calls to them. The lack of a response to then-President Obama's expulsion of Russian agents here in the United States, the lack of response by Vladimir Putin spoke loudly to the intervention of Michael Flynn. Was it one phone call? Was it a number of phone calls? President Trump then was not, he was elect, President-elect Trump. We have one president of the United States. For the President Obama to be sending one message to be countered in messaging by then the president-elect is not the way in which our country functions.
Listen, because that carries some connotations.
I think that this is the most important issue of the safety of the United States right now on two levels. One is that it deals with an adversary of the United States, someone who does not, a regime that does not have the interest of the United States at heart. And secondly, and maybe more importantly, it's about the behavior of this White House, of the advisors to the president, and of the president himself. His own behavior leaves a lot of questions to be asked. So what I think we cannot be afraid of is inquiry. And right now it appears to me that Mr. Chavez, as well as Mr. Nunes, Senator Johnson in the other chamber, have yet to take this seriously. Or at least I think they're taking it seriously. I think what they're trying to do is sweep it under the rug. You know, don't look here. There's nothing here to look at. That should raise even more questions. So as I said before, I don't think this is the end by any means. This is, quite frankly, just the beginning, the tip of the iceberg. And I think that Ms. Sanchez touched on those other points about the trip to Russia, the possible violation of the Emoluments Clause of the Constitution. And how far does that go? Who else was involved? What did people know? When did they know it? There's an army investigation into this right now. So I think that we need to have a full, robust investigation of what took place. Anyway.
Along those lines, Chavez just stepped out of their conference this morning and said no need for an investigation. This thing is taking care of itself.
It's taking care of itself.
So you're the minority. They control it. They can call the investigation or not. It seems like they're not going to. So what other recourse do you have?
Well, the American people are going to hold them accountable, first of all. I think the American people recognize when politics is at play. This is more, as the vice chair said, this is more than Democrat and Republican politics. This is about the safety and soundness of our government, of our democracy. This is not something that can be swept under the rug. The fundamental principles of our government are at stake right now. And if there is not a robust investigation, if we don't have the opportunity to ask those questions, then it's simply a laying down by the legislative branch of government. You know, I'm going to turn to Linda in a moment. And the reality that Chavez or Nunes or anyone else would suggest it's executive privilege, and therefore that's why we're not going to investigate. Since when has it been the responsibility of the legislative branch to issue an executive privilege? That's the White House. We're a separate branch of government. Let them say that's why they won't cooperate. But let the American people understand that we have a role to play, and they're not playing it right now.
Linda. Yeah, I would just add that every member of the House at the beginning of every session raises their right hand and swears an oath to our Constitution, to be faithful to our Constitution. And that means that there is a responsibility of this branch, a co-equal branch, to do the work that it needs to do to protect and preserve our democracy if they are serious about that oath to the Constitution. So again, I am calling on my Republican colleagues who want to pretend this hasn't happened. They want to look the other way and pretend that everything's fine. It's their responsibility to investigate this matter. And if they're not willing to do it, I would hope that the public sentiment among the people of their districts that they represent and the country would apply the kind of pressure that's needed to make that investigation happen. We can't force them to do it. You're absolutely right. We can't force them to do it. But the people of the United States of America can. They just need to ratchet up the pressure. I mean, Petraeus, we know, I know more about personally, and while I respect him, the end of his tenure in government was not a pleasant one, so I would need to see all of the vetting information to see if they would be appropriate in that position. I'm skeptical of the choices that they are making, because clearly they've had a series of huge missteps in terms of who they've selected. They've, have people working as advisors to Trump who are not even familiar with the ethics rules and the fact that you can't promote products or goods while in office and using using your position to do that. So I would wait to see what the vetting of those individuals would reveal. And that's about as much as I can say at this point.
I would only add to it, I know that General Petraeus had a long distinguished career in the military, and I met with him in 2006 in Afghanistan, in Iraq. But there's no question at the end, especially when it came to handling of classified materials, this is a very sensitive this is obviously one of the most, if not the most sensitive job in terms of classified material in the White House. I think it really reminds me of another point on this. My colleague, Mr. Nunes, apparently, in his statement about Mr. Flynn, thanked him for his service to America, his long distinguished career in the U.S. military and his service there. Without even mentioning the fact that he lied to the American people, congratulated him. Thank you for your long service to American people. Thanks for what you did in your position. I'm sorry you had to resign. I'm paraphrasing. I don't have a statement in front of me. Without the focus on the fact that he lied to the American people and on behalf of the President of the United States, that's what was missing there. Yes, any other questions?
We have seen a public participation and engagement in governance that we have not seen in quite some time. And so it's not necessarily rallies or crowds at town halls. It's showing up to your member's office and meeting with them. It's writing letters or sending emails or calling the office to say that you're concerned about this country's national security and you think that your member of Congress's time is well spent to investigate the intrigue that is going on right now with the White House and its ties to the Russian government. And I think that if members begin to receive that information from their constituents, they're going to understand that they have a responsibility to the constituents that they represent and to this country to carry out those wishes. Public sentiment is a very powerful thing, and again, I believe that once representatives begin to hear from their constituents in large numbers, it very well can sway those that are responsible to do the responsible thing. I think anything less than that is cowardice, and it's putting partisanship above the best interests of our country.
I would just only add to that. We look at these crowds, the marchers and the marches. They are enormous. They're enormous. It's part of a campaign that's going on. I saw it developing over this weekend by the Republican spokespeople, suggesting that people are paid protesters, that they're being paid to go to these meetings. I mean, what a dismissal of democracy. During the height of the debate on the Affordable Care Act, Democrats never accused the Tea Party people or the folks who were speaking out against the Affordable Care Act as paid rabble-rousers. This is all to discredit the credibility of what's happening at these town halls because my Republican colleagues are uncomfortable. They don't want to hear from that wing or that section of their constituency. So I get this. I understand. They're really good at it. Because, by the way, you know, they're good at alternative facts. They're great at outright lying. And now they're in charge of describing the intentions of the people who are at their town halls. Their constituents is just going to love that. Thank you all very much. Oh, do you have a question?
Yep. Yeah. Can you talk a little bit about the speaker has asked or the minority leader has asked members to have their own events this mm-hmm. weekend or next
yep.
weekend? What you're hoping to do? And do Democrats bear any responsibility for the Affordable Care Act not being as popular as it now is increasingly becoming?
I think that what you see happening here is that what I've said before is that once they touch it, they own it. And that's what's happened now. It's not about Democrats at this point right now, quite frankly. It's about Republicans. We heard from our Republican colleagues in the Freedom Caucus yesterday, vote to repeal without replacing. Well, at least they're being consistent. They're being consistent with the 60-plus votes that were taken in the House of Representatives over the last couple of years to repeal without replacing the Affordable Care Act. And what that's done, it has really been a hearkening cry to the American people and for those who now have coverage that they may very well lose their coverage without a replacement for it. So if you thought that Republicans were working towards repealing the Affordable Care Act and replacing it with something better, you can forget about all that. That's not going to happen now. It really puts, I think, Mr. Ryan in a much more difficult spot. Now, as it pertains to this weekend, yes, we're holding events in our districts to further educate, have our constituency understand the benefits of the Affordable Care Act. This has been an ongoing educational process. And quite frankly, the more people learn about it, understand that they're actually participating in the Affordable Care Act, they sometimes don't know it, quite frankly, that they like it. And so they want to keep it. But it's also to keep that attention spotlight on the benefits of that. And that's a positive thing we're doing on behalf of the American people.
I would just say, yes, members are being encouraged to do events, and whether you're in a district that has rural hospitals that are employment hubs in that area and provide services to folks who now have coverage, you're free to do that. You can do listening sessions with people who like their health insurance that had not been covered before. And I think your question about, are the Democrats somewhat to blame for people not understanding how good the Affordable Care Act, and I think there is a bit of blame there. When we passed the Affordable Care Act, there was a movement to discredit it before it was even implemented. It took several years for all of the phases to phase in, to be fully implemented. But I think people now are starting to understand just how great the Affordable Care Act has been for them. And as Democrats, we tended to talk about the 20 million people that now have coverage through the ACA. And while we should definitely celebrate that, that is a very good thing that 20 million people have coverage. We didn't talk enough about the 156 million people who have employer-based coverage and the benefits that they got through the Affordable Care Act, because we created plans with certain safeguards to ensure that their policies were good policies. These are things like, the provisions that you can't be denied for pre-existing conditions, being able to have your children on your health care plan until they're 26, making sure that there are no lifetime caps on benefits so that insurance companies couldn't just, once you hit a certain dollar amount of care, cut you off and you're on your own. We built in certain safeguards that made employer-based plans provide certain certain standards for each plan. And I think as we move forward and as we see the Republicans wanting to repeal the ACA with nothing to replace it, we need to educate our constituents about what they stand to lose. And when people understand that the coverage that they have, what will happen if the ACA goes away, people are incensed because for the first time, many people who've struggled with addiction over the years now have access to treatment for addiction. We are in the midst of a huge opioid epidemic. And many people, through the expansion of healthcare coverage through ACA, now actually have the ability to get treatment. We have folks with, illnesses, their pre-existing conditions like asthma or diabetes, that now for the first time they're able to get the preventive care and the ongoing care that they need at an affordable cost, whereas under the old scheme prior to ACA, they would never have even qualified for a health insurance plan. So, you know, we are out there trying to continually educate and engage people so that they understand what is at stake for them personally if the Republicans are successful in repealing the ACA and not having a replacement for it.
And not to mention all the jobs that are created by the Affordable Care Act that will go away with this, if it's with its demise, and the uncertainty that is created within the insurance markets itself. That one thing insurance doesn't like is uncertainty. With that, we just want to thank you all, and we'll be back again next week. Thank you, or in 2 weeks.